Hello everyone, today we are going to do Act 1, Scene 2 of the play Merchant of Venice. I'll be doing only a couple of lines in this session, and in case you have any doubts, you need to ask me when we have our online session. So here we are, Act 1, Scene 2, Lines 1 to 68. Now that you have completed Act 1, Scene 1 of the play, you must be slightly familiar with the Shakespearean jargon. So let's take a peek into Scene 2 in this module. The scene is set in a room in Portia's palace in Belmont. The characters present are Portia and Nerissa. We are introduced to the casket plot. We get a glimpse of all the suitors who have tried to win Portia's hand in marriage. So let's begin. Before we actually start the reading of the play, I'd like to do a little bit of discussion, because the scene revolves around Portia not being allowed to choose her life partner because of her father's will. So let's talk about or discuss or think about the pros and cons of love marriage versus arranged marriage. So let's look at some of the advantages and disadvantages of love versus arranged marriage. So in arranged marriages, you find that the parents are the well-wishers, whereas the people who are for love marriage feel that they know each other very well, and most probably they also understand each other very well. Now, for both love as well as arranged marriage, it's a lifelong marriage in general is a lifelong commitment. So people who are for love marriage say that it should be their decision to choose the life partner and should not be in someone else's hand. Now when you look at love marriage in certain parts of India where the caste system is basically very strong in those areas, you find that the youngsters are having a tough time in choosing the life partner, and most of the time it leads to honor killing and stuff like that. So why we are discussing love versus arranged marriage is only because Portia is in a situation where, although she is for choosing her own life partner, she is not able to do it because her father, just before he died, had designed or devised a casket test, and the person who chooses the right casket will be the ideal life partner for Portia. And so just to understand what a person feels, or what is our understanding of love versus arranged marriage, is that is the reason we are looking at it today. So now let's begin reading the scene, Act 1, Scene 2. It's a room in Portia's palace, and we are introduced to two characters, Portia and Nerissa. Now Portia is the lady of the house, and Nerissa is her lady in waiting, or probably a kind of you can't call her a servant, but she's been with Portia for a long time and almost like a companion, and takes care of all of Portia's needs. And also Portia confesses in her a lot. They both share a very good relationship. So Portia begins scene by claiming, "By my troth, Nerissa, my little body is aweary of this great world." So Nerissa says, "You would be sweet madam if your miseries were in the same abundance as your good fortunes are. And yet, for aught I say, they are as sick that surfeit with too much as they that starve with nothing. It is no mean happiness, therefore, to be seated in the mean. Superfluity comes sooner by white hairs, but competency lives longer." Portia says, "Ah, good sentences and well pronounced." "They would be better if well followed," says Nerissa. So at the start of the scene, we come to know that Portia is really tired of everything. She says, "I'm so tired of this whole world." So Nerissa says, "Of course you will be, madam, because your miseries are in the same abundance or as big as your good fortune or good fortunes are. Now Portia is from a very wealthy family. She's an heiress. She got a lot of money. So Nerissa says, if your miseries are as huge as the good fortune, I mean, as the fortune that you have, then of course you'll be tired and you'll be sick and suffered. Suffered means too much. You have too much of the miseries. So she says, you know, I think it's better, or it's no mean happiness, therefore, to be seated in the mean. So I feel that you should have a middle path. You should neither have too much nor too little. It's better to have just enough, because she says superfluity comes sooner by white hairs, but competency lives longer. So she says that excess of anything, whether it is money or whether it is worry, it's going to lead a person to have a lot of gray hair or worry and get worried and have depression. So if you're somewhere in the middle path, you will not go through all this worry, or you will not have much of gray hair or something. So she says it's always better to be in the middle path, not to have too much or not to have too little. So Portia says, yes, I agree with you. Good sentence, yeah. Good sayings, and well pronounced and well spoken, she says. So Nerissa says it would be better if you follow those, you know, if you rather practice those. So Portia says, if to do were as easy as to know they were good too, chapels had been churches and poor men's cottages princes' palaces. It's a good divine that follows his own instructions. I can easier teach 20 what were good to be done than be one of the 20 to follow my own teaching. The brain may devise laws for the blood, but a hot temper leaps over a cool decree, cold decree. Such a hair is madness, the youth, to skip over the measures of good counsel, the cripple. But this reasoning is not in the fashion to choose me a husband. Oh me, the word choose. I may neither choose whom I would nor refuse whom I dislike. So is the will of a living daughter curbed by the will of a dead father? Is it not hard, Nerissa, that I cannot choose one nor refuse none? So Portia says, you know, if you know, it was as easy to practice what you preach. The chapels, I mean, small places of worship. Chapel is a small place where Christians worship. Okay, so she says if chapels would have become huge churches and poor man's cottages would have become huge palaces. So, and she says it's a good divine. Good divine means it's only a good priest who practices what he preaches. So she says it's very difficult to follow or practice what you're preaching. I can easier teach 20 what were good to be done than be one of the 20 to follow my own teaching. So she's saying, for me it's easier to lecture to 20 people on how to be good and what to follow and what kind of rules to do, and rather than be one of the 20 who's listening to me. So what she means to say is she finds it very difficult to practice what she preaches. The brain may devise laws for the blood. So saying the brain is very methodical and clinical, and the brain devises some laws and rules and all that. But sometimes your hot temper or your impulsive nature, you know, overpowers the rules and that the brain decides, and that's because of your rash nature. So such a hair is madness, the youth. So that is how the youngsters are, she says. That is how the youth are. Youth are, a young person is. They don't bother to listen to good counsel. Good counsel means good advice. So advice that the experienced people give, it sort of cripples their style. So they don't want to listen to the advice. So, but that's what she's saying. So, but this reasoning is not in the fashion to choose me a husband. But this kind of, decision that my father has made to make me choose a husband, I'm in favor of that. And she says, oh me, the word choose. I may neither choose whom I would nor refuse whom I dislike. So I have no option. I can't say no to a person, or I'm not allowed to choose whom I want. So is the will of a living daughter curbed or controlled by the will of a dead father? Before her father died, he had written a will, and will is a document which normally people write before they die to divide their property between the family, etc. So her father had done the same thing, and she says, I am a living person whose will is being controlled by a father who is dead. And she says, is it not hard, Arisa? I mean, don't you think it's hard that I cannot choose, nor can I refuse? So Arisa says, your father was very virtuous. Your father was a very virtuous man, and normally men during the time of the death, they give good words of advice and good inspiration. So I'm sure your father devises lottery or casket test with some good thought in mind. So she says, this three chests of gold, silver and lead, the person who chooses the correct casket, he would be the one to get your hand in marriage. So I'm sure your father must have seen something in that person who chooses the right casket. So that's why probably he must have devised a casket test. So, but what warmth there is in your affection towards any of these princely suitors that are already come. So she said, how do you feel about these suitors who had come to claim your hand in marriage? I mean, do you have any kind of affection towards them? I pray thee, overname them. So give me their names, and as thou namest them, I will describe them. So as you keep telling their names, I'll describe them, and you can judge the way I describe whether I have any kind of affection for them or not. So Nerissa says, first there is the Neapolitan prince. Okay, this is the prince from Naples. Hey, that's a cold indeed, for doth nothing but talk of his horses, and he makes it a great appropriation to his own good parts that he can shoe him himself. I am much afeard my lady, his mother played false with a smith. So she says, that person, you know, he's a very unruly fellow, you know, and he does nothing but talk about horse. And he thinks talking about his horse and him being able to shoe a horse means, if you look at the horse's legs or the hoof of the horse, there'll be it has a iron metal like thing. Normally people it's a bow shaped one, and normally what they do is horse shaped rings, they hang it in front of the house for kind of a good luck. So this particular person, Neapolitan prince, he says, he keeps claiming that he can do, he knows so many things about the horse, that she says that probably his mother must have had an affair with a blacksmith. Then Nerissa says, what about the county palatine? Oh, he does nothing but frown, as he should say, if you will not have me choose, he hears merry tales and smiles not. I fear he will prove the weeping philosopher when he grows old, being so full of unmannerly sadness in his youth. I had rather be married to a death's head with a bone in his mouth than to either of these. God defend me from these two. So she says, the county palatine does nothing, but all the time he keeps frowning. Frowning means always looking very glum and gloomy and dull kind of thing. And she says, I am not very fond of this guy. And he, even if you crack a joke or if you crack a merry tale, he doesn't smile at all. And she says, I'm sure that he's going to be a weeping philosopher. Now, it's written in red, you'll find that allusion about the weeping philosopher. Weeping philosophers, no one but Heraclitus, who lived in the 500 BC and who was known to cry all the time at the sad state of humanity. So Portia says, if I have to marry this guy, then I'll be, as we grow older together, he's now, when he's young, he's crying so much. So imagine how he will be when he grows older. He's going to get worse. So she says, I'd rather marry a skull than marry these. So how say you, by the French Lord, Monsieur Le Bon? What do you think about the French Lord? God made him, and therefore let him pass for a man. In truth, I know it's a sin to be a mocker. But why he hath a horse better than the Neapolitan, a better habit of frowning than the Count Palatine? He's of every man in no man. If a throstle sings, he falls straight a capering. He will fence with his own shadow. If I should marry him, I should marry 20 husbands. If he would despise me, I would forgive him. For if he love me to madness, I shall never require him. So she says, the French Lord is another person altogether. He, I mean, I know it's wrong to mock him, but he seems to be claiming that he's good at everything. I mean, he's better with the horse than the Neapolitan, and his frowning is worse than the County Palatine. It's like he's every man and no man. I mean, he's so hyper that if he sees a bird singing, if a throstle sings, I mean, if a bird started singing, he starts dancing. And he's so eager to show off that he'll pick up a sword and he'll start fighting with his own shadow. So she says, if I were to marry him, I should be marrying about, it will be like I'm marrying 20 people. So I just don't think I'll be able to marry me. And I don't think I'll be able to love him back at all. What say you then to Falcon Bridge, the young Baron of England? Now, Baron is a title given to the noblemen of England. There are different kinds of title that the noblemen of England have. They have Lord, they have Marquess, they have Duke. So she says, what do you think about the Lord of England? You know, I say nothing to him, for he understands not me, nor I him. He hath neither Latin, French, nor Italian, and he will come into the court and swear that I have a poor penny worth in the English. So he doesn't know any language. He doesn't know Latin, he doesn't know French, he doesn't know Italian. He only knows to speak English. And Portia says, as for me, I don't know one word of English. He's a proper man's picture, but alas, who can converse with a dumb show? I mean, he looks handsome indeed, but I mean, what kind of conversation can I have with a person who doesn't know the language? How oddly he's suited. I think he bought his jacket in Italy, or his suit in Italy, his trousers in France, his hat in Germany, and his behavior looks like he's all over the place. So looks like Portia doesn't have a good opinion of this person also. So we'll end with this these lines, line 68, and in the next module I will continue the other lines. So in case you have any doubts in this particular scene, you need to note them down in your notebook or your perforated sheets, so that you'll be able to ask me those questions later when I have the online session. So make sure that you note down all the meanings and everything in the textbook, and in case I've given you some questions at the end of the slide, you need to also answer them and put them down in your notebook. So let's look at a quick recap of the scene done so far. Where does the scene set? Where does the scene take place? Who are the characters present in the scene? How is Portia's mood at the beginning of the scene? What does she say at the start of the scene? So what kind of mood is she in? What is the casket's test and who has devised it? List down the names of the suitors in the order of appearance. Thank you.